morning.
Morning, everyone. Anyway, I hope most of you are more awake than I am right now. And I don't think most of you are, actually, by the look on your faces. But good morning. Welcome again to Cayman's Financial Services Breakfast Briefing. We're very pleased to have the Minister, Honourable Minister of Financial Services, with us today, as well as Dr. Dax Castillo and one of the senior policy officials, Michelle Bandur. In 2018, the Chamber will run a series of breakfast briefings like this one. This is really a part of the series. The next one is going to be on tourism. We'll have the Minister of Tourism there as well. I know we also have three or four persons, I think, in the room that are not from financial services. So glad to see you here. The financial industry is the key driver of the economy, and I know that's why you're here to understand where it's going, how healthy it's going to be, and what the positive developments are going to be around that. The aim of these briefings is to provide an overview of the key policy challenges facing the industrial sectors, and of course how the government intends to tackle them. I also want to inform the audience that the Chamber is also carrying out a series of industry roundtables where we sit with industry practitioners like yourselves to discuss the state of your industry and any particular challenges or opportunities. We've already done this with the construction industry. We're planning to do it also with the tourism industry and involving CETA as well. And we're also planning to do it, obviously, for financial services, in which case we'll also be speaking with finance about collaborating with us in those sessions. I won't say too much more. Today we have with us the Minister of Financial Services, Honorable Tarbibas, Dr. Bastille, Chief Officer of the Ministry of Financial Services, and Michelle Bandur, Director of the Department of Financial Services. On behalf of the Chamber, our membership here, could you please thank them for participating in this event this morning. There's some very extensive bios here, and I'm not going to read all aspects of these bios. Minister Honorable Tara Rivers is a qualified attorney eligible to practice law in multiple jurisdictions. She holds a Bachelor of Arts degree from Brandeis University in Boston, Massachusetts, and a law degree from Boston Hall Law School, and an MBA from the Schultz School of Business, both at York University in Toronto, Canada. She was elected to office first in 2013, and she became the Minister of Education, and she was successfully re-elected recently, and now has responsibility for financial services. Dr. Dax is the appointed chief officer in the ministry, who holds an MBA from the University of Manchester and a PhD in strategic management from the University of Maryland. He's a published author, conducted research involving US businesses with research teams at various academic institutions, and he's a nice guy. Michelle Bandur serves as the Director of the Department for Financial Services Policy Administration. She's had that position since January 2010. Previously, Michelle served as Senior Assistant Secretary and Assistant to the Financial Secretary from January 2007 until December 2009. Michelle holds an MBA from the University of Phoenix and a Bachelor's degree in Economics and Management from the University of Tampa. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Honorable Minister Tara Rivers.
Thank you, Paul, for that short but apt introduction. And good morning, everyone. It really is a pleasure for me to be here, to have been asked to participate in this breakfast briefing to give an update about what's happening in the world of financial services. I see many, many, many familiar faces, so many of you probably know exactly what's happening in the world of financial services, given the work that you do. But certainly, I want to thank the Chamber for hosting and organizing the breakfast briefing on financial services today. And as you know, the fact that financial services is an integral part of the Cayman Islands economy, and therefore an integral part of our local commerce, it is certainly not lost on this audience. And I'm happy to be here to recent developments in this area. So during my opening remarks today, which will be brief, I'll speak more generally as the Ministry's Chief Officer, Dr. Rasdeo, will speak in more detail on certain aspects during his presentation. Nonetheless, at the end of the presentation and during the question and answer session, I will aim to add additional context and additional information or color as appropriate. That said, I want to underscore that the government and the ministry are more than willing to engage with the chamber on matters of mutual interest. So our top headline for today is that financial services continues to maintain its historic position as the driver of Cayman's economy. We continue to account for more than 50% of our GDP, as well as approximately 15% of overall employment. Direct fees from the financial services sector account for roughly 40% of the government revenue. From a jurisdictional comparative perspective, according to the recent Global Financial Services Index, rated countries of 110 countries, Cayman is among the top 25 best financial centers of the world. In addition, for the 9th consecutive year, the Cayman Islands has been named the world's number one specialized financial center, according to the Bankers Advocacy 2017 survey. Now, we maintained this position despite 2017 being a challenging year for countries with financial services industries generally, and for Cayman was certainly no exception. In fact, during the past year or so, we had assessors from the OECD's Global Forum on Transparency and Exchange for Tax, or for Information for Tax Purposes, and the Caribbean Financial Action Task Force. And we underwent the EU's screening process to identify jurisdictions that it considered to be non-compliant in tax cooperation. While again, Dr. Basdeo will elaborate on these in his presentation, I must point out that the government's proactive as well as reactive response to these initiatives can be measured in the more than 40 pieces of financial services related legislation that went before the Legislative Assembly in 2017, in addition to the numerous face-to-face and written engagements which took place throughout the year. And for this, the government is very appreciative of everyone in both the public and private sectors for your great efforts in assisting us to develop appropriate enhancements to our legislation and our practices, and also helping us to develop responses to the various requests for information, etc. You see, appropriate partnership with the financial services industry is part of the foundation to being a successful international financial center, which is to the benefit of all stakeholders. So, we're just at the beginning of quarter two for 2018, and as expected, this year has been no less challenging, no less busy, no less engaging. We have sought to begin to implement recent legislative changes. We have begun to anticipate and develop further legislative changes that may be necessary during the course of the year. And we have continued to increase our international engagement efforts going forward. In anticipation of this activity, the 2018 and 2019 budget increases for the ministry approved late last year amount to roughly $2 million to the financial services departments, $2.5 million to CIMA, and $780,000 to industry associations per annum. This is a significant increase in investment across the board, and as Minister, I will continue to fight for further increases as and when necessary and justifiable to continue to support the work of the Ministry, the work of CIMA, and the work of the industry alike. Given that, you all are here because you have a vested or other interest in financial services. So I don't really anticipate any objections as to the increase in government budget to support the industry, particularly in the light of industry's recent continued advocacy for more funds. But just for the record, The overarching objective of this government is to ensure that our jurisdiction continues to thrive and to attract all of the sound business that we can possibly attract in as many lines of financial services business as it makes sense for us to pursue. Of course, in doing so, our reputation as being commercially innovative and adaptable, yet a suitably regulated jurisdiction which adheres to global standards will be key. Hence, our increased engagement in the United Kingdom, in Europe, in the US, and Asia, to attempt to debunk myths and to educate key audiences. Ultimately, the evidence of our success will not only be the reinforced strength of our industry locally, but the strength of economies and societies globally, as well as our own. Together, we must develop fact-based, data-driven messaging points to help tell the reality of the value-addedness that, as a jurisdiction, we bring to the global and offshore domestic economies. And we must each, through our own spheres of influence, not shy away from telling our story in a convincing and compelling manner. In fact, industry and government must become even more proactive in doing so, because to do otherwise, we run the risk of others defining our reality for us. And I don't think I need to elaborate on the dangers that that will bring. Our biggest challenge right now as a preeminent international financial center is not about regulatory compliance. It is a perception problem. A perception problem which, as an industry, we have allowed in some cases to linger and in other cases to fester, because those of us who know better either have not taken the time, or in some cases, quite frankly, couldn't be bothered to address the misconceptions and misperceptions often perpetuated by popular media and otherwise. We have a great story to tell, and I'm sure I don't have to convince you of that fact. But collectively, we must do more to tell our story. So with that, I look forward with working with the Cayman Islands Chamber of Commerce as a stakeholder, and as the Cayman Islands, as we continue to advocate, to demonstrate leadership, to cooperate, and to innovate in order to maintain and enhance our status as a leading international financial center. Thank you, and I hope you have a very enjoyable and productive morning through the course of our discussions.
Given that financial services is largely driven by have a financial services advisory committee, which is comprised of a lot of local law firms, drafters, support, ministry officials. And they've done a great job over the past 8 years to build and develop new legislation and new products that are really pushing the boundaries for competitiveness as an industry. A great deal of work has been done in terms of the ELPs, LLCs, LLPs, a few other ones, but again, foundations. It's been a real benefit to the government to have the support of the industry to develop a decision in partnership to make sure we are making a competitive advantage. This year, the plans are to look at the competence law, to make a few enhancements, again, to make some improvements, and also to look at the insurance law as well. On the limited side, we're looking forward to the full implementation of limited liability partnerships. Key this year is the systems to support the legislation and a few other things to make sure it's operational at the end of the year. Principal or local concern, we are also considering new design rights legislation. Late last year, there was introduction of design rights. This year, we're considering making that more of a local registration process for the UK. On the more regulatory side, there are a few things also this year. Two of these are small changes to amendments as things have clarified since their introduction, particularly in the non-profit organizations law. But other things, again, immediate changes on banks and trusts and civil as well. This is not exhaustive. This is sort of the plan, the ones we're working on. There are quite a few others I'll get into as we go through the presentation that are in development. But as of now, we sort of worked out the exact changes not on this, but in response to things like the EU non-profit jurisdiction listing, there are a few other changes to be made, which I'll go into a bit later. As well as a whole host of other small things that pop up during the year, I think the Ministry of Financial Services is one of the most prolific developers of legislation in the government. As the Minister said last year, there was 4 pieces of legislation. Down there, dealing with laws and otherwise regulations. So we're very much on track every year, trying to make sure we respond to the needs that you identify, concerns, issues, clarifications. It is a big part of our work, and we're fortunate enough to have dedicated drafting support in the government, and we prioritize our legislation. That's about our key resource to make sure we get up to our jobs. Anti-money financing of terrorism. As you may know, last year, December was a very important step in the overall assessment process. International standards, as dictated by the International Action Task Force, which changed those standards in 2012, came out and had its on-site inspection in December. The first draft of the report that we've seen was in January. The second draft is due next week, Monday. Third draft that we've done sometime around June, ahead of plenary discussion on the overall report in November of this year. So those who are familiar, we've spent a lot of time in the last 2 years, and last year in particular, passing amendments to make sure our framework was up to scratch. In terms of the FATF standards, this year the focus is more on the ongoing discussion with the assessors to make sure that they got it right, make sure they understood what we said, understood how far we've come in terms of our standards, and to make sure that that's reflected in the report that will go to the FATF plenary. That report then becomes public in roughly by February of next year. So, in terms of a major standard, a major point to look at the repetition of the jurisdiction, having a very strong report is essential to our application. The FATF standard, as I said, did change in 2012. And one of the things that they introduced was this concept of effectiveness. So not to just look at laws and what's on your books, but to make sure you're doing things right and that the practices is what it's supposed to be. This has been a challenging issue. So get the text in the slide, what I'm showing is the color. There are 11 factors to look at effectiveness, and of the roughly 50 jurisdictions that have gone through the assessment and have their reports published, you see the amount of red and orange on that screen, you'll see how difficult that's been for more. tax transparency is something that I think you've gotten very good at, and you see most of the reports these days from international bodies, we are starting to be very well recognized for tax transparency. We've been engaging with the OECD and the Global Forum for the better part of 10 years, or a bit more actually. But because of that ongoing engagement, I do think we have built some strong allies, both at the sort of OECD international level, as well as with other governments, with those individuals in those governments who are specialized in the tax area. And because of those relationships, they're a good source of information, a good source for us to understand what's going on, and they can be our advocate because they know what standards we're operating towards. So our engagement at that level has been quite key to making sure that the area of tax transparency is being recognized for our Cayman. And therefore, not one of those issues that we need to focus overly on, we've got to maintain because it is underlying most assessments and it is personally into the way we're viewed by most of the world. Key things this year ongoing, CRS, our reporting standard, and country-by-country reporting, which has been introduced. These are, again, key parts of the EU assessment, which I'll get to in a bit as well. Then the ownership. Starting point I want to make here is that beneficial ownership, although something that has been driven by the UK in the last year, from the standpoint of the exchange of notes we signed back in 2016, beneficial ownership is based primarily on the NBTL standards. It is, viewed from the AML perspective, we've had an AML regime that needs to be over the better part of 15 years. We've done better than most jurisdictions. The UK step in public registers is something of an anomaly, but because of our issues, something we've had to focus on to make sure that they're defending us where appropriate. But beneficial ownership is based on FATF standards, and that's the standard that we're working towards. Again, we're not considering any public registers. We've done the approach, I think, that is best for our jurisdiction. We're quite collaborative with the industry to make sure we're doing the right thing across the beneficial ownership. There are a few changes that were made late last year to improve the EU-related legislation, mainly to make sure that it works in practice, that it comes to issues on the compliance side. That will highlight it based on discussions as part of the CAA assessment. There's a grace period case that comes to the end this year, the decision is June 30th. By that time, we need to have a system fully operational, fully populated. By and large, exempt companies and LLCs are utilizing one system that will be being enhanced this year. On the local business side, just for general members, for smaller businesses, there is a requirement for beneficial ownership that does need to be completed by June 30th. And the different system to use that's a lot more convenience is that you have to use service providers. There is a system that registered to use, the Cayman Business Portal, which is operational. I think that would be useful for Jimmy to have a session with them to explain how that online tool can be used for small businesses. There are a few functions in terms of the interaction with the register that can now be done online through this portal. And therefore, small businesses should take advantage of this resource. LLPs also need to have an amended form of beneficial ownership as well as new structures. Again, that's something that perhaps should be a surprise to anyone. EU listing. The EU list of non-corporate jurisdictions for tax purposes was dominated over our discussions last year. Because of the significance of the EU's emphasis, their threats of sanctions, and the fact that it may be seen as a political issue. We had an interesting time late last year, and I really want to highlight just how important it was for the Minister and Premier to be engaged face-to-face in Brussels with ambassadors, with prime representatives, to really push our case and ensure that the EU officials and others know just what we stand for and where we are with legislation or framework. That was a key thing that got us not blacklisted, perhaps, or greylisted, perhaps that's the term we want to use. We did make a commitment to the EU to make a few changes this year, and we have until the end of the is a big key issue for us this year, as we want to avoid excessive sanctions in the EU. Not necessarily because of the EU business standpoint, because it would not want to affect our reputation that would affect work in other jurisdictions. So all along we've had an engagement. Again, we do our best when we're in front of other jurisdictions, other officials. We have a great story to tell. We've been working hard for the past decade plus on some of these sort of security issues. And we find when we are building those relationships, we are convincing others of the strengths of our jurisdiction. It is making a difference. We've seen that firsthand. And some of those allies are again our good sources of information, our good persons to work from, to work with us to certainly help us advance our work and our agenda and our reputation. We have a very full year. We're traveling almost every month of the year. We've given the minister a break over summer, but otherwise she's going to be on the road a lot. Some major engagements. I've had a few ones that we've done so far. Early this year, through the finance, New York Records, so also key down on the calendar. But since then, Minister Anne Michelle just returned from Washington, D.C., where they had some extremely useful kind of a meeting with some sort of with a lot more detail on. Other plans for this year include visits to Brussels and also the UK to make sure we're continuing to stay on top of the issues that I want to those stakeholders to make sure that they understand that our commitment exists, stands, we're continuing to make sure we're doing the best for our jurisdiction and upholding our international obligations. Again, having those engagements face to face are key for our success and therefore we have a very comprehensive calendar this year to make sure we're continuing to do so. Financial touch on fintech, that's also a very current topic. Recently, the ministry, in collaboration with the Cayman Monetary Authority and the Department of Commerce Investment, had a working group look at the issue of cryptocurrency, blockchain technology, what it means for jurisdictions and things for nations. That report has been finalized and submitted to the ministry at this point. What needs to be done, what needs to be regulated or otherwise in terms of legislation and our framework. So again, another key area of perhaps growth for business, but one that has been a thorny problem to make sure we're on top of doing the work necessary to make sure that opportunity is being capitalized on the jurisdiction. Now, I know there's a bit of a world in terms of all these major issues, and I can really scratch the surface on many of them. A lot more detail in terms of how each of these areas affect us in terms of opportunities or threats for our reputation and the business we do. But I think the key point is that we believe we are on top of everything that's going to be of major concern this year. And we're very much looking forward to work with the industry stakeholders to make sure we're putting in place plans to address these challenges and make sure we continue to be successful. It has been a challenge as a ministry and government as a jurisdiction for the past 3 or 4 years, particularly because of the major assessments and major developments. So far, I think we're on the right track. We've kept on top. We've met the challenge and I think we're going to continue to do so. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thanks very much, Minister and Dr. Bansky, for that update. Anyone from the floor? Questions? Do we have any? Yep, here. Will?
First question of the morning. I represent the Cayman Islands Development Bank, so heavily involved in the financial services. with debt, and they're not part of the clearing bank system where they do credit checks. They don't conduct credit checks. So people are overextending themselves at really high rates of interest, and is causing problems for a lot of the financial institutions.
We've had some discussions with CIMA on that very issue, and broadly speaking, from a more domestic standpoint, the local commercial banks on a range of issues that are affecting consumers locally. They put this on the agenda, perhaps not as kind of profile as some other things we're working on, but it has been a discussion. I don't know where it's at this point in time.
I have a question, but I'll wait to the you mentioned legislation to ensure there's sufficient economic substance locally. Could you expand on what we have in mind? I'm sure that's probably most difficult question that I could answer today.
So I'll start with kind of overall principle of what I expect the ministry to do in respect to developing the appropriate substance definitions. And again, I believe that it is certainly not a one-size-fits-all type of model. It will depend on the business line itself, even the financial services, and the expectation of the policy scale and direction that the ministry has been given is certainly to continue to engage with the EU on helping them to determine what it is that they really have an issue with in this regard, but also, more importantly, to engage with the industry. Global industry and local industry, not just associations, but as I said, dealing with considerations that are appropriate for the different business lines which we have in the country to figure out what are the opportunities and how we can and define and enhance what we currently offer. So looking at this challenge as an opportunity to increase business per chance, but also the ultimate determination will have to be very heavily influenced by the support and the information that industry provides. Because we want to, as I said, the goal of the government is to continue to ensure that we have, we facilitate a thriving financial services industry that capitalizes on as many business lines as possible that make sense for our jurisdiction. And you guys will know in the industry what your how the products work, how your clients, the expectations, what with their sensitivities and appetites, but I believe everybody understands, even as an example, in a conversation that I had with a number of very high-profile private equity and venture capital managers in Hong Kong, the issue of substance was raised, and there was a lot of discussion generated about clients actually wanting to increase some level of economic substance in the jurisdiction because of the pressures that they're facing in their own tax jurisdiction. So, but it's about determining what that is. And certainly the ministry, as I said, has been, the steer has been that this can't be done in isolation. It can't be done solely with the conversations with the EU. It has to be done in tandem with the industry. So we will really be looking for industry to help us create those definitions. So the fact that the EU has not, you know, given that clear cut, this is what we expect as of yet, it's a great opportunity for us here in locally to help to define what that means in a real way that actually benefits the jurisdiction. So that's the overarching approach that the ministry has been given to guide this process.
Minister, carrying on with that discussion, part of that may very well be, I think many people in the room would agree,
immigration policy is key to that substance, right? Is the government looking at providing this industry with a little bit more flexibility with work permits and other ability to get international labor if we're going to be required to have substantial economics, or sufficient economic substance? Because I would have thought that bodies on the ground here, meaning human capital, may be part of that definition.
Thanks for that question, Will. And I this is where the answer can't be a one-size-fits-all definition for what would be appropriate or required from an immigration policy perspective. It will really depend on, you know, again, in the line of business. So, for example, we're certainly not trying to create a manufacturing industry where you need to have boots and ground factories on, you know, to create a thriving financial services business. But in some instances, it may require more of those, you know, the capacity of building locally to have boots on ground. In other areas, we may already have the service providers who are here, who are based here, that can extend their services in ways that we may not necessarily offer today. So again, I think this is the kind of conversation that we need to have on a business line by business line approach, and then look at the ancillary type of legislation that may need to be amended in order to facilitate appropriate economic substance.
Additional questions?
Economic substance is not defined in the way that we pursue legislation or change our framework to how we do it right now. And so what we said, even consulted work to what was the best for the jurisdiction. What I want to add to that is that we've been working quite closely with the Senate of OECD, and because the OECD has looked at this issue for a longer period of time, there is a body of work that they have been doing that we look to understand what it means from an international perspective. The EU is slightly different in terms of its approach, and while they are looking to the OECD's work to sort of be based on their own decision off of, they make some things unique to the EU in terms of what they want to see that we can't get at this point in time. But as of last week, there was a meeting in the EU on this issue, and we do know that they're leaning more towards the rest of the OECD, and therefore it's going to help us to formulate our own plan.
Additional questions?
Morning. Your presentation back focused a lot on threats to the jurisdiction and essentially protecting what we have. It's often said that the best form of defense is a good offense. Can you talk to us a bit about the process for identifying opportunities for new forms of financial services, offerings and providers, fintech aside, which you touched on, and specifically any additional opportunities that you see in the current environment?
But this is where we look at the industry to be able to pursue opportunities, and I think on those slides were a few opportunities themselves. Starting off with the push to develop new commercial legislation, again, we've got a good history of working with the industry to develop those, introduce them, and make sure that we are seeing the top jurisdiction. That is certainly a key opportunity. Even some of the threats are opportunities in the sense that as we go through these processes and we convince others of the strength of jurisdiction, it means we have less grounds to stand up and attack us. And I think we're starting to make differences, change in opinions, which then will lead to better education, more business. Those are opportunities in and of themselves. And in particular, through our engagement, that is where we are being much more proactive and ministerial, as I said. Key engagement to make sure we are advancing our jurisdiction, and that's why we have to focus on involvement, and that's what we're being brought up on that side of things. Also, fintech itself is an opportunity. We do know that businesses are picking up locally. We want to make sure we're protecting our reputation in case anything goes wrong, or we can make sure we're spinning any issues that have come from that kind of business.
Additional questions? I'm wondering about the potential threat of a public beneficial owner register. I know this was, I think, discussed in the UK Parliament recently. And I was just wondering, these are some big discussions in the BBI. I know they have a bit more worry about something like that, but I was just wondering if there was any discussion on that.
Well, certainly, I think, as Dr. Bazio mentioned in his presentation, and I'll reiterate, the government does not support implementing the public beneficial ownership register. We do not believe that it is global industry standard. We've got evidence from FATF and other professionals, former UK National Climate Agency entities as well, speaking out against the effectiveness of public registers. And we see the UK themselves having challenges, and people actually highlighting the deficiencies of having a register that isn't verified or that's just relying on self-reporting. So, but the reality is, it is a political issue, and the reality is the Cayman Islands, we are constitutionally linked, obviously, to the United Kingdom. So it is a real challenge that we have to continue to address with the UK, with the legislators of the United Kingdom that understand the position that we take, but of course, they're in a situation where it's very politically sensitive because that's the system they have. So I'm not here saying naive to expect that anybody in the floor of the House will come up and speak against a beneficial ownership situation. I mean, these are the political realities that we need to appreciate. But the fact is, we were very successful in through the efforts of the information provided by the Ministry, working in tandem with the UK's government, the Cayman office in the UK, and actually getting information, relevant information, told the, in this case, the Conservative Party members in the House of Lords. And they actually, even though I believe, and again, do not quote me on this, but I believe the understanding was that they were really, even at the House of Lords level, they were concerned purely from the numbers whether or not they were going to win the defeat of the and I think that's what you're referring to now, the defeat of that amendment that was being debated, because they just statistically didn't have a surety of the numbers, but because of the arguments that the legislators that did speak up on our behalf, and our behalf collectively, not just Cayman, but from all the overseas territories, they actually were able to defeat that amendment in the House of Lords. Now, we do know that a similar amendment has been filed in the House of Commons. That debate hasn't come to fruition yet, so we're continuing in our efforts to try to provide the legislators, you know, the information that they need to be able to defend their jurisdiction and say, listen, we're doing what we're committed to do. We're actually doing it in some cases at a higher standard than other jurisdictions, not so much focusing on deficiencies in the UK, obviously. But this is where, when I spoke to the fact that, you know, we collectively need to work on this messaging to ensure that as a government, myself as the elected official dealing with my counterparts in the UK and other countries, the Ministry of Policy team, we have the data to show that we aren't the bad guys that they're wanting to try to convince the wider public and certainly their colleagues when they're having these debates. We need to have the data-driven information that says actually, you know, it's because of investments through human vehicles that they were able to develop the kind of public housing that you have in X county. I mean, all politics is local, and we have to remember that, and this is very much a political issue. And that's why many of you heard me speak to this, and you'll hear me speak to this theme as long as I sit in this chair. You, and I appreciate all that has been done to this point, but the threats are real. It is increasing because of the political nature of it, and I will continue to rely very heavily on industry to help me help you help us ensure that we don't actually have to go down that road as a result of losing a vote in the House of Parliament in the UK. And again, that's one of those political realities. But certainly we're prepared to do all we can to defend and promote the jurisdiction the way that we've been doing it thus far.
I have a question, just for myself. Just regarding the economic substance issue, and I just wanted to get it clear in my head. There is a commitment has been made at a very high level to put some things in place to address the issue of economic substance by the end of 2018, which I understood. Is there or is there not a set of criteria or some ideas or anything that we know we have to put in place so that the other side that we address this issue, or is it left to us to take measures that we
necessary and are reasonable to address that issue? Secondly, are we going to go the route, Minister, of asking for some sort of transparent global standard on what constitutes economic substance, given that there are a lot of differences currently in the EU itself with their nations regarding what they define as economic substance? It's not clear. And if that's not clear there, how can we come up with criteria and have boxes to check off before December 2018?
Again, I'll start with some of the kind of high level issues, and I'll ask Michelle to kind of give us the detail to the extent possible about the actual conversations happening out in the technical teams. To your point about the lack of this kind of international standard of what economic substance means, again, I think it's very much because there cannot be a one-size-fits-all model given the nature of the differences of even the business lines within financial services. So certainly the team has been tasked with the responsibility to try to push the envelope to ensure that, you know, there isn't the cherry picking, so to speak, as it relates to certain jurisdictions and not others when we're talking about a particular business line. So to your point, pushing for the idea that, you know, global standards, and we've always said we're willing to adhere to, we're willing to cooperate with any standard that is market practice or market industry standard. But some instances it makes sense to be leaders, some instances it doesn't, and that's the kind of sensitivity certainly that I continue to try to help the ministry determine in a way that makes sense when they're having those government to government, intergovernmental negotiations. But I think in terms of where we're at right now, I'll ask Michelle to kind of give us an overview.
I'm sorry, from a more technical perspective,
then, particularly concerned that the EU is not pushing forward that, to digest it, to have sort of discussion with the regulators, with the industry, with the actual entities that are seeing these happenings, then the expectations that we're going to move to try and develop an appropriate legislative framework to address some of these. Because of course, with any innovation, innovation far outpaces regulation, as we know. But we know, we are aware that this is an area that we, you know, as a jurisdiction, because again, it's one of those, what we call potential industrial sort. There's great opportunities for the jurisdiction, but at the same time, we need to make sure that we are protecting and enhancing the reputation that we have and not cannibalizing on the kind of lines of business that we do that. So the whole purpose of